Kia ora. Tēnā koutou kei te mana whenua e mihi mai kia mātou I tēnei ata, huri noi tō tātou whare, tēnā koutou, kia ora tātou katoa. Good afternoon, and I just wanted to acknowledge the our Archdeacon Joseph this morning for his welcome and prayer, and welcome to all of us. And it is Cook Island Language Week as well, Alfred, kia ora ana. So, where do I point this? Right. Okay, so I'm going to talk to you obviously about education, but first of all, can I thank you all very much, Prime Minister, for your fabulous leadership and support, to our President and Board, to colleagues, delegates and friends. We all do very much appreciate all the work that all of you do, and those of us who are on the list particularly are grateful, because actually I wouldn't be in Parliament without you and be given the opportunity for the Prime Minister giving me this job. And I love this job. It is every morning I get up thinking, what more can we do to raise achievement for every one of our New Zealand children and young people? So yeah, the press have a field day on everything negative, but underneath all of that, there is great stuff happening across the New Zealand education system. So I want to take you through some of that today. Last year we were debating whether and how to publish national standards data. Now we have not only published the first and second lot of national standards, but we've established a five-year public achievement information framework. We've introduced regional data, and I will have outside there copies for anyone who's interested in their particular regional education picture, as well as at national and school level. We've now done it by year level, gender and ethnicity. We now receive it 3 months earlier than we did last year, and it is now the basis for setting actual targets for real kids and real achievement in every school. And whereas last year we were working with over 400 schools that had not submitted their national standards data, this year we're down to just 13. Last year we were debating... Last year we were debating what and how a charter school could be introduced. Now we have completed the policy, introduced and passed legislation, processed the applications, and are in negotiation with the finalists for the start on day one, term one, next year. Last year we were dealing with the discovery of a sex offender, person A, in a number of schools. Now we have completed a comprehensive review of the New Zealand Teachers Council, which is responsible for registration and disciplinary matters of the profession. We've conducted an intensive consultation across the entire sector, and we will introduce legislation before the end of this year to transform the council into a 21st century professional body. Last year, we were heading into collective bargaining with all the teacher unions. Now, we have settled all the teacher and principal employment agreements, as well as a number of smaller ones, with just two left to go. The fastest, most affordable, and for longest terms. Last year, we were beginning the process of renewing the education network in Christchurch. Now, we have final decisions on all but 8 schools. We have 4 mergers underway. We have 2 new schools being built with plans for 14 more. We have 38 community-based achievement plans from the community themselves, and a business case is being developed to invest $1 billion over the next 10 years into the Christchurch network. Last year, we were exploring the potential for a dedicated managed network for schools. Now, with the great work of Associate Minister Nikki Kaye and Minister of ICT Amy Adams, and over a $700 million investment, the Prime Minister last week launched the Network for Learning. Last year, we were ramping up the secondary tertiary space with youth guarantee products. Now, with the great work in that, across that space with the Honourable Stephen Joyce, we have more pathways, more funding, and more places for real young people. And yes, we had NovaPay, and that work is also being done under the incredible direction of Stephen Joyce, and we are now well within the margins of the previous pay system. So last year, We had a lot that was going on. Very little of what I've just told you has been reported, but you should know that there is good work being done across the education system, and we are seeing achievement being raised for each and every one of our New Zealand children. So, unfortunately, I don't actually have this presentation in front of me, but I think what it says is that the biggest contribution a government can make to its people is to raise the achievement of its children and young people. That will mean that they can raise their own living standards without being dependent upon the government. That will mean that we can grow the productive and competitive economy that we must do as a small, high-quality nation. We will never out-procreate those nations with which we trade, and nor would we wish to. But on the basis of an excellent education, we can out-create, out-smart, out-think, out-innovate. And that's what our education system needs to produce. When we came into government, we inherited a system where basically three out of four kids were getting the qualifications that they needed to succeed. That's not good enough. We're not an average government. We're not an average country. We want five out of five of our children succeeding, and that's what our education policies are committed to. But too many of those one in four who are not succeeding are Māori, are Pacifica, come from poorer homes. And it is in all our interests that we have five out of five young people succeeding. There will be hip operations in some of our futures. There will be stents required in some of our futures. We will want excellent tertiary health care, which of course Tony Ryle is delivering, but we have to have an economy that can fund that. We want to have the best possible roads and highways. We want great schools. We want technology into every home. That requires that all of our workforce is productive, not some, but all. And that's why we are focused on raising achievement for every one of our children. Our approach is to work with parents first and foremost. Parents, families, whānau, ainga. Because parents have the greatest interest in their children. Yes, teachers do for the 30 hours of the school day, or the 25 hours minus those teachers on duty at lunchtime, or the 20 hours that the collective agreement has allowed for actual contact. Whatever it is, our kids spend a significant time in schools, but they spend the most time in and of and connected to their families, and their families are powerfully motivated for their children to be successful. I have not yet met one parent who does not want the best for their children. Not one. And I say to teachers who complain to me about the kids they've got, that parents send the best ones they have. They are not keeping at home the good kids and sending along their naughty ones. That is what it is, and it has been so in every generation. Teachers taught through the Great Depression. Teachers taught through World War II. Teachers taught through Vietnam. Teachers taught through all the social unrest of the 60s and 70s and so on and so forth. Yes, we have challenges in these generations. They are just different challenges, and we must all rise to meet them. So parents are most invested in their children, and we have to make information available to them so that they can be informed in their engagement with schools, and we have to give them courage and confidence to take to engage and to go along. And I've said to whānau and ainga, if all five of you want to go along, mamas and papas, go. This idea that only one parent can turn up is just a cultural construct. So just take along whoever is interested and invested in these kids and have the discussion. But we need to work with our profession. And by the way, New Zealand doesn't have a world-class education system by accident. It has happened through generations of hard-working, committed principals and teachers, of researchers and academics, of people who every day go into classrooms and schools up and down our country to make magic with the learning of young people. And it is It is a no-brainer that we need to support these people to be successful, because they are the ones who deliver up the raised achievement for our children and young people. The third part of our approach is about performance, and I'm going to cover that shortly, which is about, as speakers, the Prime Minister and the Deputy Prime Minister have said this morning, we are a government that is prepared to be accountable. Now, that actually might sound really straightforward to regular people, but governments haven't necessarily said, this is what we're going to do transparently and clearly, and then show what we've done and where the gap still is. But we are committed to doing that, because it raises performance across the public service based on raised expectations of taxpayers. So performance I'll come to, and then the platform. Now, this area of work is the bundle of responsibilities that Nikki Kaye has as Associate Minister when she's not being full on food safety as she has been in the last week. She tells me she's aged 10 years. It looks good on her. So platform. Modern learning environments. Many of us went through schools which we now know to be old and cold and not conducive to the best kinds of learning. And so this platform is about bringing information communication technology into well-designed, bright, light, energy-efficient classrooms, and we are consistently reviewing our property portfolio so that we can do that. Nikki is also leading work, much to the satisfaction, although not yet the complete acceptance of the Minister of Finance, on how we can get greater efficiencies into our property portfolio. And I'm interested in that too, because for every five education dollars, two go on property. And I need that cut to about, 50 cents. I need all the rest of it to be in curriculum, teachers, learning, etc. So those are the four things. As I just said, the data speaks for itself. So out here, waiting for all of you, for the first time, you will be able to pick up this education system at a glance. All of you will be able to pick up a copy of this this afternoon over afternoon tea. This is the first time ever we have a data framework that allows us to look into our early childhood and compulsory schooling sector. It will tell you, for instance, that there are 832,000 5 to 18-year-olds this year in our schools. It will tell you, for instance, that 62,900 children started school in the last 12 months. That was an increase of 0.5% of girls and an increase of 0.8% of boys. It will tell you what achievement is in reading and writing and mathematics, both in English and in Māori schools. It will tell you, in terms of our better public service target, that 85% of 18-year-olds is our goal to achieve NCEA 2 or better in 2017. We set the baseline for that for the first time last year, because obviously you can't measure what progress you've made if you haven't established a baseline from where you start. So we had to hunt through New Zealand. I love this target because it is indifferent to whether 18-year-olds are at school or not. In other words, our kids are going to turn 18 somewhere around the country, and we need to know that they are equipped with a passport for life, that they have understood that learning is earning. And so we established our baseline at 74.3%. That's how many 18-year-olds had NCEA 2. As I say, it was easy enough to find the kids who had these in school, but we went and looked at, were they in the youth justice system, were they in SIPS care, were they NEETs, just where were they? We got NZQA on the job to find the kids who had NCEA 2 but didn't know they had it. All right? Because in this system, of course, you get 80 credits and you can leave school not quite with NCEA 2 and do two or three credits at a tertiary institution and not realise that that creates your 80 credits, or you cannot afford to have your certificate printed. So we've made that possible for it to be accessed online. And anyway, it was 74.3%. In 12 months, we've gone up nearly 3% to 77.2%. Every secondary school now has an achievement balance sheet. It tells them what the last 5 years of their achievement was by gender and ethnicity, and it indicates to them what they need to achieve over the next 5 years if their school is to get to 85%. We had two principals acknowledged in the Sir Peter Blake Leadership Awards this year. From Two Hawks Bay High Schools, Flaxmere and Tamatea. Those two principals went into those schools in 2010 and in 2012, 3 years later, had doubled the achievement out of those schools. It is possible with quality leadership and strong engagement of the school community to make those kinds of differences. So this is fantastic. You know, you can spend a happy couple of hours this afternoon. No, you can't, because there's so much more to hear from this fabulous government. But this tells a story. And then those who are also interested, for the first time, we've published regional profiles. And out there, there will be copies of the 18 regions. So I've got Auckland's here. As the Auckland MPs have already informed me, crisply like chips, could we please break down Auckland into more specific areas? So TLA data will be coming to a TLA near you very shortly. So you can pick those up outside. So this is the bottom half of that. This is what's happening with our up the left-hand axis, you will see the ages of children. Right, the ages, and that will tell you which part of the education sector we're working with. What are our priorities? We've already set those out on the handout as well, and there are a number of them, and again, you'll be able to look at those for yourselves, but I want to pick out a couple from them. The first is strengthening the profession and raising its status. As I've already indicated, there are fabulous teachers and principals across New Zealand just doing outstanding work. East Tāmaki Primary School, for instance, had a real problem with how they would raise maths, a predominantly Pacifica community. They've adopted now what people in the sector called Bobby Maths. Bobby Maths has been designed by a lecturer out of Massey University, and they too now have their kids way up at 70% and above for maths by finding how to turn the learning lights on of the kids in their class. And there are stories like this all around New Zealand, fabulous stories. So I consider it imperative that we work on how we support the raising of the status of our profession, because who would want to join a profession that was constantly bagged? So when it's on here, it says, what can you do? And one of the answers is speak well of our ECE and school professionals. Like any workplace, there's a bell curve with really outstanding, exceptional principals and teachers on the right and not so much on the far left. Just making a little political analogy there in case you didn't get it, okay. And then through the middle, a bell curve of distribution. Our challenge, and mine as Minister of Education, is to keep moving that bell curve right. Keep moving it towards excellence all the time. So, and there are a number of things that we're doing to make that happen. And then the second thing I just wanted to pick out, because again, these priorities are written down and you can see them, is our 21st century learning and digital literacy. It is not enough to have launched the Network for Learning, which is providing for a managed network for all of our schools by 2016, and for there to be uncapped quality data and a great portal, but we also have to support what in the education parlance is pedagogical development. In other words, making sure that our teachers and principals know how to use this tool to, look, just frankly, to have an outbreak of learning. And so we will be focusing on that together with Nikki Kay. Don't worry, Paula, I'm finishing up. Oh, there's the where to from here. On the back there, we're working to provide better information to parents on the progress of their children, well-informed parents, are an unstoppable force. Developing better data for regional and business leaders to support pathways to employment. We'll be opening partnership schools next year. Creating a strong professional body for the profession. Oh, and let me finish on this. We will be hosting the International Summit of the Teaching Profession in Wellington next year. Shortly you're going to foot stomp and tramp and clap and punch the air, because this is the World Cup of Education. It is the apex of education. Hey, I'm still building here. So this summit involves the 25 top performing education systems in the world and the 5 fastest rising. We went up against Canada, Hong Kong and Belgium. Canada and Hong Kong are currently ahead of us on PISA. We went up against those 3 countries to get it. I was at Amsterdam this year for this summit, and New Zealand's delegation was just, you know, astonishingly outstanding at the summit. And anyway, we were asked, were we interested in pitching? So I said, yes, you know, New Zealand would be interested. And then the summit ended, and then everyone went off for drinks, and then my advisor rushed back and said, Minister, everybody's tweeting that they're coming to New Zealand for the summit next year. And I said, crikey, what time is it in New Zealand? And she said, 6 o'clock. You'll love this, Prime Minister. The PM will already have been up an hour. And so I said, geez. You know, and other words like that. So I texted the Prime Minister and the Deputy Prime Minister, and I said, you know, I'm at the summit, it's going really well. It looks like, you know, there's reasonable interest in New Zealand hosting it. I thought we could. What do you think? And the Prime Minister came back and he said, go for it, which he does. And I did. And we won it. And I came home and I put out, hang on. So I put out a carefully crafted press release about just how fantastic this achievement was. After all, we had whole well-funded delegations going all around the world to get the Rugby World Cup, didn't we? And we had well-funded pitches for, what's that boat in San Francisco? And all of that sort of thing. But here I was with one advisor in Amsterdam making a pitch for us to host the equivalent in education. So I come home, I put out a press release, and I'm thinking, wow, this is just like, you know, finally we're going to get positive headlines about education. Nothing. Nada. Not a thing. And yet 3 weeks ago, we happened to get 3 games for bashing a hard ball around with a bat somewhere in Christchurch, and balloons are popping and champagne corks. So anyway, I'm telling you, this is fabulous, and we'll be hosting it in Wellington in March next year, and it will be an opportunity to showcase to our visitors what a great system we have, but also to New Zealanders what a great system we have, but that we have to keep working at it. So finally, onwards. Thank you very much.
Got time for a couple of questions as well, so if you like to just, yeah, we've got a couple, have we? Oh.
Over here to the right.
Yes, here we go.
Keeping it on the positive note, of course, that...
I've got this, yeah. Tēnā koe, Minister, and acknowledge you for your hard work and tenacity in this portfolio. Last week there was some research released around the Reading Recovery Program, 30-year-old program, and the research shows that it's not too hot and it's failing our kids. And the suggestion was that, who did this research, said they reckon they could do it a lot cheaper and a lot more effectively. Are you going to be looking into that?
Yeah, so the more fundamental challenge, so Reading Recovery was developed, you know, in a time that was appropriate for it, and nothing stands still. But the more fundamental challenge to our education system is actually not to rely on supplemental aids which reading recovery is. Reading recovery, as its name suggests, is to recover a kid's literacy because they haven't yet got it established. Actually, our challenge is to put the best teachers into the years 1 and 2 classrooms, because when foundation literacy is established there, you're not trying to catch up. You've got a little jet engine under you ready to take you through. Yet too many schools put their young, new female graduates into the years 1 and 2. So that's actually the initiative I'm more interested in. Well, I'm interested in these other things too, but actually, instead of spending money for second chance reading, let's get the first one right. Okay.
Am I on? Good. I'm Janelle's layabout husband. I'm from Helensville. My name is Brent. I'm on the board of trustees at a college. And one of the things that's concerning them and me, because I'm in IT, is the lack of IT being used in schools effectively. Many schools mandate devices and things of that sort, but they haven't joined the link up into how to use them effectively in an educational environment. One of the challenges, which is partially addressed by the Network for Learning, is how to get more schools onto the internet, get more schools using cloud-produced international products to deliver education. But the issue, especially in Kaipara, is that where you're struggling to pay for electricity and you're struggling to feed your kids, how can you provide an internet? And how could kids use computers at home when they probably couldn't leave them there and expect them to be there in the morning? Any comments?
Yes. We have examples of how each one of those problems that you've talked about has been overcome and overcome spectacularly across New Zealand. One of the most referenced examples is the Manaia Kalani, which is in Point England in Auckland, which is a Decile 1 community, and where they have established an approach which has every child, it's the whole Point England, all the schools are networked into each other, which is, so they're not acting in isolation, and every child has a device, and that device has been paid for a third by the school, a third by the Telecom Foundation, and a third by the parents. Now that requires the parents to pay, I think, $1.50 a week, and maybe with the exception of one or two, every parent has paid every week, and as a result, there's high ownership and pride and commitment to that project. It's also had the unintended and very welcome outcome that some parents who've never had a good credit history now have one because they have regularly paid their child's device. So there are examples like that. We also have quite established, and we had a talk this morning by Charles Bennett, Newton. Charles Newton, talking about the Nelson loop here and the early work that the school, 55 schools are a part of the Nelson loop here. There's a loop in Wellington, there are VLNs across New Zealand. So we aren't devoid of examples of how it can work and work well. There are a number of them. The challenge for Nikki Kay and me, and she has set up a reference group precisely to deal with these challenges, is how we can socialise more of those examples, investigate in new and more persuasive pedagogies, learning approaches across the system. And in terms of affordability, once all of the schools are on, they will have uncapped free instant data. It is the fastest internet connection. So we expect 700 by the end of next year and over 2,500 schools who wish to join up by 2016. Thank you. Last question.
Hi, Carolyn O'Fallon, Wellington Metro. I just had a question about, we have such a focus on getting IT into schools and that. I just wondered if is there any thought given to old-fashioned keyboard literacy, like typing? Because in my experience, my kids went through school, about 5 different primary schools and 4 different secondary schools, and never has they've been taught any typing at school. And I think if we're expecting them to be keyboard literate, why don't we teach them to be it in an effective way?
The evidence is pretty compelling that kids learn how to use the keyboard without being taught how to use the keyboard. If you're talking about typing and the touch typing of our generation, then that's not what kids do. I mean, they do whatever is the fastest way to get to where they need to get to. So if they're going to use two fingers and a thumb, as opposed to, you know, being able to look at the screen and use your eight fingers or all of that. So no, that hasn't been a priority at all because we haven't actually found it to be a challenge. What happens is kids motivated to learn by interesting and engaged parents and teachers find their way through that. And in fact, boys, there's quite a bit of evidence, and Charles talked about it this morning at the Education Policy Advisory Group, that with devices, boys' writing has improved significantly. So let me be clear, not their holding of a pen and writing, but their ability to express themselves by using a device. So we have seen that happen significantly across the board. So thank you all very much for your engagement. Do not go home without your copy of the Education System at a Glance and what it is that you can do to hasten our approach to raising achievement for 5 out of 5. How many? 5 out of?
5.
Oh, a bit better than that. 5 out of? 5. 5.